ago, before I became myself a Wall Street broker as well as an investment banker.
Mm-hmm.
So I know what it is and how difficult it is for them to even imagine getting their company listed.
Yeah.
But trust me, it's like anything else. It's like riding a bike at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
The first few days is difficult, but you know, it's a simple process.
Excellent. Well, it's well explained, actually, and I think part of your prerequisite, which differs you from the other exchange, is that the companies have to be Sharia compliant. So maybe if Professor Dar can just, I know in a previous show you kind of explained it, but can you just summarize what do they need to do before they can float?
That's right. Actually, even before the break, I mentioned that any company which is in a sector which is not recognized by Sharia would not be allowed to list on this new Sharia stock exchange, Sharia UMEX.
Mm-hmm.
What are those sectors? Anything to do with alcohol, anything to do with pork, anything to do with interest-based financial services,
mm-hmm.
anything to do with the weapons, tobacco, and immoral activities, gambling, casinos, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So these sectors are untouchables. Okay, we are not going to allow any company which is involved in these activities to list itself on Sharia UMEX. Then comes the other areas, the financials of the company.
Mm.
Ideally, for an Islamic enterprise, it should not get involved in any Sharia-repugnant financial activities.
Right.
However, given that there is some flexibility in the market, we would like to apply the criteria, financial criteria, which are already in practice in the market. So debt-equity ratio.
Mm-hmm.
Debt-interest-based, debt-equity ratio shouldn't exceed 33%.
Mm-hmm.
Cash plus interest-bearing securities divided by market cap shouldn't exceed 33%.
Right.
Receivables as percentage of market cap shouldn't exceed 33%. If a company fulfills these criteria, this company is eligible to be listed on Sharia UMEX.
You know, Mahesh, he was kind of quoting some stats. Now, I want to really know, and I'm sure the viewers also really would like to know, can Islam play an impact in the economy?
I will give you an example. We are, in fact, doing a project in Wales.
Mm.
We are planning to build an industrial, halal industrial park in Wales.
Okay.
That would provide close to 3,000 jobs in that area. Now, when we talk about 3,000 jobs, the industrial park alone would probably take 500 to 1,000 jobs.
Mm-hmm.
But all the ancillary services, logistics, packaging, all those things will then come to support that industrial park.
Right.
So, in addition to that, if you look at the halal industrial park, the meat producers, the dairy producers. So even though we have only 2 million Muslims here, we have close to 70 million Muslims in the whole of Europe. And in fact, we could effectively become a very interesting export hub for halal from England. And in fact, I believe, again, I say I'm a non-Muslim, but I, as an economist, as an outsider, I can see that halal and Islam could in fact play a positive role in the UK economy.
Mm-hmm.
And after all, we are a exporting nation of food, but you know what? We import meat to actually cater to the halal sector here. When we have a meat industry, we have a poultry industry, and we keep importing from New Zealand, Australia, from Brazil, and purely because we ourselves are not consuming or utilizing the resources we have today, which will not only take our own products, we can export it, use it for home consumption, but also provide jobs multicultural. We're not just talking about just only assisting and supporting Muslim community. And this would be seen very positively within the British economy, where Islam really plays a positive role in economics rather than always taking the back seat on a negative and always being looked negatively.
Right. Okay. I think Abdi wanted to make a quick comment on Eagerly Holding.
I just had one question.
Yeah.
He was talking about the listing process.
Sorry, we digressed.
Yes, that's okay. Just one question. How much would it cost? How much would you envisage it will cost to have a company listed successfully?
Okay. It depends on which. There are three tiers to our market venue. Okay. Mm-hmm. One is the junior market, which is for small companies, growth companies getting on the exchange. And we have put a cap with all our professionals not to exceed £50,000 in the whole process. And that's what we brought all the professionals together and said, we want small caps, small companies to go on to this and try to tap the capital markets. So if you're raising, and fundraising would be something around £500,000. So you're looking at 10% costs overall to enable that company to list. That's on the small cap. The mid cap is somewhere a little cheaper than that of AIM, which is roughly AIM today. If you want to take a company on AIM, it's anything between £300,000 to £400,000, depending who you're talking to. Again, here we have capped it to £225,000, purely because the professionals that we are working with, we have come together and said, let's provide a turnkey solution to this sector, because let's not outprice ourselves from the market, and try to encourage enterprises to enter into this market venue. On the top tier, we haven't put a ceiling at all. After all, that will be it. The next phase, when we're looking at multinational companies looking at listing on that platform. But right now, we're focused more on the small cap and the mid cap companies.
Okay, unfortunately we're running out of time, but Professor Dar, could you just give us a few seconds of your time?
Basically, I would like to summarize the things. You know, Mahesh talked about job creation, the impact of Islam on local economy. Actually, there is a global context as well. When we look at the financial services industry, in this crisis, a number of people were fired from the conventional banks. And I should say that in about 50% of them got jobs with the Islamic banks and financial institutions. So it's a kind of an Islamic banking and finance has played the role of in a buffer zone. You know, the impact of financial crisis was huge. But because Islamic finance was not that adversely affected by the financial crisis.
And unfortunately, as on the note of huge, we only got a few seconds left, so we're just going to wrap it up. And I'm going to apologize for all the callers that were holding on. Unfortunately, we couldn't get you through in time. We're going to do another part, inshallah, and go into more detail. So stay tuned. Watch us next week. Assalamu alaikum for now.